Hi, this is Lindsay, one of the co-hosts of Beauties and Headcanons. Thanks for listening to the following broadcast on Public House Media.
This is Bryce Burge, host of Your Soccer Passport here on Public House Media. After this episode, come join us on a trip around the soccer world as we discuss club and country every Tuesday. Stamp Your Soccer Passport by subscribing on Spotify, iTunes, or wherever you get your Public House Media podcasts. And thanks again for checking out the following broadcast on Public House Media.
Welcome to Let Me Be Forward. I'm your host, Baxter Colburn. History not once, but twice has been made for Forward Madison FC. This was a great week to be a fan of Forward Madison. It's a great week of soccer. 5 goals over the courses of 2 matches, 1 in USL League One and 1 in US Open Cup. Welcome inside the show. I am your host, Baxter Colburn. As I mentioned, a great show in store for you this week. A 3-1 victory against Toronto FC 2, a game that I said was maybe going to be a draw, but hey, TFC not coming to play in Forward Madison, now that they've escaped Snowmageddon, had a little bit more up their sleeve than I think some folks, myself included, thought possible, which is great. And a 2-0 victory over the Milwaukee Bavarians in the opening round of the Lamar Hunt U.S. Open Cup. That and much more to get into on the show today. How you doing? How's your week going? How's life? How are things since we've chatted last? I know there's a lot of things that are going on in the soccer world. We're going to get into that with our news and notes section here in just a minute. A reminder for you, the show is available on Apple Podcasts, on Spotify, CastBox, wherever you get your shows. We are there for you. We're also available on publichousemedia.org. They are our presenting sponsor, so a big shout out to PHM and all the great shows and content that they do on their network. We are also on social media. Yeah, maybe you've heard of us. Maybe you've interacted with us. If you don't follow us, well, shame on you. Get after that. It is Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram are the best ways to get a hold of us, at Let Me Be Forward on all of those fine platforms. Instagram, it's at Let Me Be Forward Podcast. You can follow myself at Baxter Colburn, and Maddie is at Maddie Cum. That's MaddieKumm. Did you remember that our live show is Saturday? Yeah, I hope so. This coming Saturday, we are going to be in Milwaukee, not Madison, but we'll be in Milwaukee for our live show from 2 to 4 p.m. at the Hive. We have 3 different members from 3 different supporters groups coming out. Woo, baby. We are going to have April. We're going to have Andrew. We're going to have Omar. And it is going to be a party. I was told that they are working on getting the Forward Madison beer at this event. It's free to the public. You just got to show up. You just got to come and have some fun. Maddie and I are going to be there doing some interviews, chatting, just networking. It's also, if you're just a podcast fanatic or just want to chat soccer and just want to come and hang out with some folks, hey, this is the place to do it. This is the time to do it. And I hope you will join us this coming Saturday, May 11th at the Hive in Milwaukee. On Milwaukee Street, I believe. Don't quote me on that officially. You can go to the Hive's Facebook page. We'll share out the event again also on our social media channel, so check out that as well. This week is all about recapping the history, but of course also looking forward. So let's do it. Let's look into the news and notes from around the soccer world. A big thing I want to jump at right away, in MLS, actually, expansion club FC Cincinnati have fired their head coach. Yeah, they fired their head coach after a 2-7-2 record, so he's only been with the club in 11 MLS games, but he has officially been fired due to, truthfully, just being downright wretched, if I'm going to be totally honest, and not exactly what you want from your head coach, on exactly what you want from your squad. So, of course, that's going to make total sense to me that you're going to see him dismissed. Other big news, this from USL League One. Don Smart was named the Player of the Week after his 2 assists and 1 goal led Forward Madison to their 3-1 victory this past weekend. Looking at the standings, this is where it gets interesting, ladies and gentlemen. This is where we have to start keeping an eye on things. Forward Madison sits in fifth place right now in the USL League One standings with a record of 2-1-1 in league play. TFC2 just above them, even though they have 7 points. They've only played 4 matches. They have a record of 2-1-1 as well, but a +1 higher goal differential than Forward Madison. Some very interesting losses and draws on this past weekend. I'm not going to lie, I was a tad bit confused, as I always am when it comes to some of the games that took place. Tuesday night, we had talked about this last week, Tucson beat Lansing Ignite 2-0. Friday night, we saw Orlando and Chattanooga draw 0-0. Very shocked by that. North Texas beats Greenville 1-0. Richmond and Lansing draw 2-2. And then Madison wins 3-1. The games that have me scratching my head is the fact that Greenville, once again, holding North Texas, and Orlando and Chattanooga. Chattanooga thought you were a pretty decent soccer club, and you draw Orlando City B. I don't know. Daryl Shore was on the program a couple weeks ago and mentioned the fact that he's like, Orlando's a good soccer club. They are going to win games, and we feel like that is certainly the case, and I don't doubt that. I feel like that is very possible, and it is going to continue to happen, but outside of that, what are you going to do? One other note from the women's soccer department is the fact that the U.S. women's national team roster for the upcoming FIFA Women's World Cup is officially out. The 23-woman roster is there. Alex Morgan, Tobin Heath, Allie Long, among others. The only notable absence that many are speculating is Casey Short, one of the young up-and-coming defenders, was not included. And Allie Krieger, a veteran, was indeed included. So some surprise, some shock, but the U.S. women's national team looking for an opportunity to go out and repeat as World Cup champions. With all that being said, we have our interviews this week. Joining the program, we have the player of the week. Yes, we do. Don Smart is here, and he is ready to chat with our very own Maddie Cum. Maddie, Don, take it away.
So you had, honestly, a stellar game last week. You had 1 goal, 2 assists. Tell me, when you're going against an undefeated team, where did that come from? How did you get that going?
From the beginning of the game, the coach kind of gave us a heads up to say that we got to go out and take the game to them, you know. We just got to keep pressing first 15 minutes and see what the game had for us. And we see that we had them on the hill, so it was from the get-go. We just had to just go for the game, you know.
I think something that's really unique, too, is that you were the first signing in club history. So, you know, being the first signing and having such a major role in that game, how did that feel?
It was a pretty big game for me and also for the team and for the club, you know. You know, each player just kind of played a role on the team. You know, I'm just here just to help out the team and whatever it takes to make us to get the victory to the championship, I'm going to play any role that the coach wants me to play. Players want me to play. I'm just going there for 110%.
Right. And speaking of, you were fresh off a 1-game suspension because of a red card. So how did you really prepare to bring it for this game? Do you think that suspension gave you even more motivation and fire to come back and really be a huge motivating factor for this team?
Yeah, I think it definitely did. I think I kind of put my teammates down and all by getting that red card to actually sit out a game. I was kind of pretty frustrated and upset about it. And, the players, they had my back all the way on the coaching staff. So it's just that I had to just get my head down and just get the practice and just work even harder, you know, to get back. Because, you know, I kind of left my team out there stranded, you know. So coming back to this game, you know, I just wanted to go out there with a burst.
Right, and I would say you definitely made some waves when you came back. Of course, like I said, huge, huge push, huge success for Ford Madison, winning that game. The fans were going wild. You said in a previous interview that you chose Madison because it's a new challenge and you want to bring excitement to this city. After seeing the flock and all the supportive group, do you think you've accomplished that?
I don't think I've accomplished it yet. I think I'll accomplish it when we get to the championship. That's when I feel like we're accomplishing everything. But that's why now it's an ongoing thing, and I'm pretty pumped to see these guys come out each and every game, you know, to support us. And they do actually give us a big lift in the game, you know. They kind of give us a push in the game. And I really want to thank the supporter groups and the fans for coming out and actually doing that for the team.
And my last question for you is, we have Chattanooga coming up. Unfortunately, last time you played Chattanooga, didn't come back with the win. What's your strategy going forward this time? What's going to be different about this game so you can bring home that win and bring it back to Madison?
We learned we just got to be patient in the game, you know. We can't take the foot off the bricks now, you know. We had a 2-game winning streak, and, you know, with a big win tonight in the Open Cup. We just got to, you know, keep pushing forward, you know, keep working hard. Help by each other, and then, you know, it was the result, you know?
Right, and so since we're recording this tonight, when this broadcast tomorrow, people will know that you guys just won. Tell me about that game. Tell me about the game a little bit.
It was pretty game at first, you know, playing a non-league team is always, you know, hard because these guys come out and give us, you know, they always come and give us their 110%. So, you know, we had to be in a game, you know, and with the weather, and, you know, had their fans coming in to support them. It's always going to be a tough game playing a non-league team, but I feel like we came out and got the job done early, and, you know, we kind of got the win, and it was kind of good for the team and the supporting groups and also the club, you know. So that was a big win for us tonight.
Right, and again, this is a brand new team. What would you say is working for this team right now? Again, coming off this great win last Saturday and that great win tonight, what's working?
Togetherness, you know. All the players, we stuck together. You know, the coach Daryl said it from the beginning. It's like, if we're a team, we stick together. We do everything as a brotherhood and stuff. You know. We're gonna get results no matter what, you know. Drew Dixon, you know, that's how teams is, you know. It's not every game you're gonna come and have your best game, but, you know, once you have that one teammate to help you get through it and lift you up for the next game, it's very big, you know. And I feel like that's a big thing with our squad coming into these games. Like, all the guys are together, you know, helping each other out, working hard every day in practice, and, you know, just looking out and giving the other person next to you a helping hand.
Well, I think that's a great note to end on. So thank you so much for sitting down with me for these few minutes. I know you've had a busy night again, fresh off of another win. So thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
No problem.
Time now for our weekly chat with head coach of Forward Madison FC, Daryl Shore. Two big victories to talk about this week, and that's the first time in show history that we get to celebrate two victories, one in USL League One and a fresh victory coming off of the Lamar Hunt U.S. Open Cup. First and foremost, welcome back to the show, Coach, and a big congratulations on two big wins as well, sir.
Well, thanks, Baxter. It's glad to be back, and it's always good to talk to you, especially after a couple of wins.
Absolutely, right? It makes life, the press is so much more tolerable, right, when everybody wins, right?
Everyone loves a winner.
Exactly. Let's talk about Toronto quickly. A 3-1 victory. Take me to halftime. You guys are tied 1-1. Paulo gets that first goal, and then an incredible just single effort there by Toronto FC to level it up just before halftime. What were the changes that you made to then obviously go on and get that 3-1 victory that seemed to obviously work well for you?
Yeah, it was obviously a good start for us to the game, with the exception of the one play where Brian has to bail us out again, which he's done time and time again. But felt like we started the game a lot better than we had the previous matches. So we were pleased with that. When we came in at halftime, we felt like they were giving us a little bit of trouble by bringing their right back inside and keeping their two attacking midfielders up high and bringing their center forward deep, which was causing us some problems. So we just made a couple of adjustments of how to deal with that. But offensively, we felt like we were getting after them pretty well, getting the ball wide and looking to get in behind them, which I think was evident on the last two goals that we scored. So we had quite a bit of success in the first half doing that. We just felt like if we could just lock it down a little bit better defensively, we were still going to get plenty of chances going forward. And fortunately, this time we took our chance as well and scored some goals.
Absolutely. And it was definitely one of those matches where I think it kind of just kind of grew on folks as it kept moving along. As you mentioned, you made those changes at halftime and then you get a second goal. And then obviously Don's goal at the end is a little bit more consolation than anything. You kind of had, sealed it at that point. But I want to get your thoughts because Don Smart, obviously one player of the week. We just had him on the show here just a couple minutes ago, but give me your thought, because he doesn't play obviously last week because he's gone with suspension. What did he do to get ready for this game? Because to come out and drop two assists and a goal certainly makes it seem like he'd been working a little extra hard than what we had seen in the first previous weeks. Not to take anything away from him, but it seemed like a revitalized Don Smart.
Yeah, I think it was just more what we did as a group. And we felt like though we have been playing good enough soccer to get results, we still felt like we weren't challenging our guys enough to get in behind and look to get behind their opposing team's defenses. And really that's where Don and Paolo really are at their best. When they can run behind defenses and we can find them in those good spots, that's when those guys can have success. So it's just one of those things where, as a team, we worked on it this week, this past week, over and over again, just with some pattern play and then just some different possession games and games to goals where we really focused on getting our wide guys, and not just our wide guys, but I think you saw in the game a couple of times where Mason Toy ran in behind with some success, and then also running Jeff and Joe Ciel out of the midfield quite a bit. So those were things that we kind of focused on this past week. We felt in scouting Toronto, those were going to be areas where we could have success. And that found the game well. Anytime you can put him into space, there aren't many defenders that are going to be able to run with him. And he had quite a bit of success getting behind and then obviously having the composure on the second goal to cut it back to Carter coming inside. And then, like you said, the third goal is icing on the cake. But I think it's more a reward for him on the night for having a solid game.
Absolutely, yeah, and I think that it reflected based on his performance throughout the entire evening, and it was good to see. I want to get your opinion about this also. What, in your opinion, and I know you can probably only give me such an answer that only Daryl Shore can give me, but is Ryan Coulter, in your opinion, your starting goalkeeper moving forward? Is that what we're seeing? Because obviously Brian is healthy. We saw him play Tuesday night. But give me your thoughts here, because obviously Ryan is playing exceptionally well. Of course, that wasn't the role initially he was brought in for, but he seems and is playing like he should be the starting goalie until further notice.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those where we like to create competition on the field for every position. So Ryan is actually out of the country right now working on his UEFA goalkeeping license. So he's out a week. So now it's a chance for Brian to get some games. And so now when he comes back, if we go, obviously we win the Open Cup game. And now if we get a result in Chattanooga, now Ryan's got to work his way to get back on the field. So I've said all along it's important to have two number one goalkeepers on your roster, which we think we have. So now it's one of those where the two have to compete. And it's hard to take Ryan off the field right now, and Ryan understands that. But at the same time, if we go out and get a couple of results in the Open Cup and in league play while Ryan is missing, then you can argue that it would be tough to get Ryan off the field. So it's a good problem to have. The good thing is that these guys push each other to make each other both better. And at that time, it'll make our decisions, though tough, easier, knowing that we've got two quality goalkeepers on our team.
Well, speaking of having to make tough decisions, Tuesday night saw the emergence of Brandon Eaton, and obviously we already knew a lot about Hiro Toyama with how he's played, but Brandon Eaton was the name on many fans' lips throughout the evening. Talk about his performance, a 2-0 victory, of course, the very first in U.S. Open Cup history for forward Madison, playing in a historic club in the Milwaukee Bavarians. It was an away game, even though it was only, 90 minutes round trip for you guys, but tell me about the atmosphere. Tell me about Brandon Eaton specifically and how he turned out to be a great quality piece for this victory.
Yeah, I mean, I think it just shows a little bit of the depth of our team, and the message going into today's game was, some guys that haven't logged a lot of minutes were going to get a chance to play, and now it was on them to make the most of it. And it's a night where now Brandon takes it upon himself to show that he has been competing hard in training and working hard. And he's been on the tough end of a couple of decisions where he's either been left off the 18 or he's been in the 18 but hasn't gotten any games. So for him to come out and put a solid 90-minute performance together, score the opening goal, and just have an all-around solid performance, it just shows that we've got guys that can play when our starting guys aren't either up to par or now when we need to rest guys. So it's good to know that you can count on guys, not just Brandon, but I think Ali Ngonzi steps in and gets his first minutes for us. And so another one who we thought had a good performance tonight. It's, these games, when you have 3, 4, 5 games in a span of 14 days, you've got to test your roster, and you need guys to step up and play big roles. And tonight, Brandon did that.
Tell me about Milwaukee, because obviously what they did very well was play physical, and I think that was very evident no matter who you are in any level of soccer watching the game. It just always felt like they ran and they ran and they ran, and even the commentators on the game tonight said that you would never, he's like, one of the commentators had said, if I had been asked to put money down if this Bavarians team would still be running at full speed in the 90th minute, I would have said that you were crazy and I would have lost money. But he said the commentators and even a lot of the fans watching were just taken aback by just the energy level that Milwaukee had all the way down to the final whistle.
Yeah, I mean, they have guys in their team that have played professional soccer. You've got Ty Dombrowski and Scott Lorenz, who both played in Major League Soccer in the early 2010s and whatnot. So they've got guys that if they didn't have jobs as engineers and doctors and lawyers, probably could be playing at the professional level. So we knew this wasn't going to be an easy game. We knew that, they were going to be fit, maybe not 100% soccer fit, but they were going to be able to run around. And that was one of the things we kind of told our guys coming into it, was if we're not good on the ball and if we don't protect ourselves, that they were going to try and disrupt the game and everything. So it was important that we got the early goal. It allowed us to settle in. And then I think, you could argue that we scored the goal of the year for us, total team goal with our second goal.
Mm-hmm.
Probably one of the better counterattacks I've seen in a long time. So a good quality second goal. And now, you kind of feel like the game is in the bag, but at the same time, we tell our guys at halftime that this is one of those games now where if you don't put your foot down and put your stamp on the game, it could come back and bite you. And it didn't come back and bite us, but I would say that we were on our heels a little bit more than we wanted to be in the second half. Part of that was we were going against the wind. Part of that was we got a little bit complacent. But at the end of the day, I don't think Brian was really called to make any major huge saves, and it was a good job by our guys to close the game out and finish it off on the right note.
Absolutely, and it was definitely good to see a lot of the fans for Forward Madison traveling to the game. Also, I mean, obviously not the longest trip they'll make this season, but it was great to see some key members and some key supporters groups make the drive. And I think there was at least a bus or two that I heard was rented of fans to come over to the match. So that was great to see from the supporters.
Yeah, I mean, Baxter, you can't say enough about what's going on in Madison, and our fan base is, again, chanting and screaming and hollering the whole game, and even a few of the Bavarian players after the game just coming up to us and telling us how awesome it is that we've got such support. So can't say enough about our supporters group, the flock, and the rest of our fans. It's a big message to our players that we are supported and that we have a lot to live up to, and fortunately now for us this past week, we've given our fans two good reasons to keep traveling and keep supporting us, and we're going to keep trying to do right by them by trying to get results.
Absolutely, and that next result will hopefully come Saturday when you go back to Chattanooga. Any comments about that match, Fast? Chattanooga coming off a 0-0 draw with Orlando City this past weekend, and now Chattanooga looking obviously to stay undefeated at home. Obviously the defeat against them in their home opener, one of those two victories that they have. Any changes or anything that you've seen Chattanooga make since the last time you met them a couple months ago?
Yeah, they've kind of been a team that does well at home but then doesn't do so well on the road. So they're coming off now a loss in the Open Cup, which I'm sure they're not going to be too thrilled about, but for us, it's not many things are going to change. We felt like that first game we went down there and we played, if not well enough to win, we felt like we deserved at least a draw out of that game. Mm-hmm. So it's a good matchup for us. We've got to now get back to Madison and check on our health and see where guys are health-wise so we can make a wise decision with our lineup. Also now thinking, you don't ever want to think ahead of an opponent, but now knowing that we play Saturday, but then the following Wednesday at El Paso in the Open Cup, which is a big chance for us to show ourselves against the USL Championship team. But we won't look ahead to that one until after Chattanooga. We know it's going to be a tough game. Ayman Saeed is dangerous. Stephen Beatty is dangerous. They've got a lot of other players that can hurt you, so if we're not good on the ball and if we're not tuned in defensively, then it could be a tough night for us. But I think our guys will be up for it. Again, felt like we deserved better that first game of the year. And so now you got to look at it as here's a chance to get back at a team that gave us our first loss.
All right, Coach. Always a pleasure, sir. Good luck on this coming Saturday. And it's going to be a very wild ride these next couple of weeks with U.S. Open Cup and Tormenta and all these other fun games you got coming up. So looking forward to our conversations.
Yeah, it's a tough month ahead of us. And then obviously it concludes with playing Hertha Berlin. But our guys are looking forward to it. They love the play. They love the support. And just looking forward to getting these games over with so we can get back home in front of our home crowd.
Absolutely. Daryl Shore, always a pleasure to have you on the show, and let's do it again next week.
All right, Baxter. Thanks a lot. She's running through my mind all day. Hey, Shardy's like a melody in my head that I can't
keep on. Got me singing like... Time now for the Loon Report, your weekly look inside Forward Madison FC partner club, Minnesota United. Well, the Loons this past weekend were part of a thrilling 1-1 draw at Allianz Field. They saw Christian Roldan rocket a goal in from 23 yards out to pull the Sounders level at one apiece with Minnesota United after Iko Parr's beautiful back post header. That was a pretty header. But 1-1 the final score coming out of this one. The Sounders looked like the better team for some of the match, but let's be totally honest here. Minnesota United brought it to the Seattle Sounders in this Western Conference clash. And with this 1-1 draw, now all of a sudden Minnesota United still find themselves in sixth place. It doesn't matter what they do, they just can't seem to get out of sixth place. They are now 4-3-3, undefeated still at home. 1-0-3 at the home coliseum, as it were, the gauntlet that has been cast at Allianz Field. Sounders 5-1-4 with a 19-point total in their column. This was a good game for many folks to watch, and this coming week you're looking for more, of course, as you look as Minnesota United. The next time that United will be on the field will be on the 11th, this coming Saturday, as we've talked about, at 7 p.m. They take on the Chicago Fire in Chicago. That's going to be a fun one as you look over in the Eastern Conference standings. The Chicago Fire, only 10 points to their name, but the Eastern Conference is literally wide open as far as those bottom 5 to 6 teams. And if Chicago were to get a victory, that would put them into the playoffs with that game if they were to get that win, which is really funny to think about, honestly. So that's the Loon Report for you this week as we talk a little bit about every week the partner club of Forward Madison FC, Minnesota United. A 3-1 victory over the weekend saw Forward Madison claim another notch in their belt. A big home victory, the very first one in Forward Madison history. So they are now undefeated, continue here at Bree Stevens. That's a great result, if you ask me, because this was a game that we knew was going to be challenging for the Mingos, and they decided that, no, it wasn't going to be challenging. They were going to dominate the game. They were going to just completely outrun and outgun. But if you look at what happened on paper, obviously it's a little bit of a different story. 3 goals go in for Forward Madison, while TFC2 outshot Forward Madison 16-14, but only put the same amount of shots on target. Only one of their shots goes in. Of course, Ryan Coulter again has himself another day. Let's break this game down very briefly. Looking at it in the 33rd minute, of course, Paulo Jr. gets on the end of Don Smart's wonderful cross in the back post. He heads the ball in, they go up 1-0. Let's talk about Schaffelberg's goal, because if you didn't see the replay, go back and watch this man's goal, because I had to watch it a couple times because I was completely taken aback by just the number one drive and determination of this man to go and get this goal, but then just to stay on his feet, the balance, the ability, and just the pure striking form that he was able to just slot the ball perfectly past the outstretched hands of Coulter. And it was just a great goal when you talk about the individual effort from the young Schaffelberg. Second half, then you pick things up. Carter Manley comes in on another a seemingly just upfield run. I mean, he was very far up the field for a right back, honestly, if we're being honest here. And he comes flying up the field, and Smart chips a little ball into the middle, and he hits it one time, bang, to the bottom of the net, 2-1. And it looks like it's going to be a 2-1 finale. And then all of a sudden, in the 96th minute, Don Smart pops up again at the back post for a nice little tap-in goal. And that really just puts the bow on the match in front of, once again, another capacity crowd in front of Lionel Messi. There we go. I wanted to say Messi is what's in my head, but Lionel Messi, the new cow, of course, was there at this match. And it was just another great environment as Forward Madison continues to just find their feet, figure out what it's like to play with a consistent offense, looks like what it's good to play on as far as quality weather. Think about it. Some of their matches have been kind of all over the place as far as the weather that they've had to play in, and this was a great victory for them in front of a terrific audience that was in the match. Where do you go from here if you're Forward Madison? You have to be excited. You have to be thrilled with the fact that you get a 3-1 victory because you're just literally, you're tied for essentially being in the playoffs, but you're not because of goal difference. But now you have a great opportunity to go play a struggling Chattanooga Red Wolves team this coming weekend. Chattanooga, as we mentioned, they draw 0-0 with Orlando City. Chattanooga has been spotty the last couple weeks. And now Forward Madison, who has picked up some steam, this is an amazing opportunity for them to be able to go out and possibly steal 3 more points. Chattanooga, they haven't won a game since April the 20th when they beat Tormenta 3-2, but they lost to Richmond, and then they drew this past weekend, as we mentioned, against Orlando. Chattanooga, They are a little bit of a different story. This is what they've done since Forward Madison. They beat Forward Madison 1-0 in the opener. They lost to Greenville 1-0. They beat Tormenta 3-2. They lose to Richmond, and then they draw Orlando. I don't know either. I really don't know. I mean, they obviously lost to North Texas 3-2 in their very first game, but like I said, since they played Forward Madison, they haven't won a game on the road, but they are undefeated at home, which obviously is what you want. If you can defend the home, then you can certainly be a very good team. You can be a very mid to high level table team if you can stay undefeated at your home venue all season long. Will that be the case after this coming weekend for Chattanooga? I don't think so. I'm getting to that point now where I can say I strongly feel like Forward Madison is a good offensive team. Now remember, I gave them a B minus C plus last time on the show as far as their offensive, just their overall production on the field, especially speaking from the offensive side. And this 3-1 victory, especially with Don Smart, has me inching. You're probably at around a B, maybe a B plus now. I want to see a little bit more. This needs to stay consistent. And we're going to talk about how they continue to stay consistent here in just a second when we talk about the U.S. Open Cup match. But they are on their right path. They are doing the right things because they have to go and take Tormenta on in 2 weeks. And Tormenta doesn't mess around, okay? So Tormenta is going to be looking to bring all sorts of hell, as it were. Because look at this. You go Chattanooga, Tormenta, North Texas, Lansing. These next four games are going to be insane, and they're going to be very difficult because Forward Madison, this is the time where you really get to say, okay, we got the parts under the hood. They seem to be working well. Everything seems to be finally moving. We got a good sound. Now let's see what this puppy can really do. Let's get her out on the track now that we've really kind of worked out some of the kinks and see what we can do. Chattanooga will be a great test, but Tormenta and North Texas back-to-back, that is going to be the big thing that I feel like is going to be a good gauge. When we walk into that June 1st game against Lansing, we're going to be looking at, in my opinion, at a very different Forward Madison team. And that's a good thing because as you play the games, as you go through the season, you're supposed to get better. You're supposed to be just growing and you're supposed to be learning and you're supposed to be figuring things out as a club. I wanted to ask this question on Twitter this week, but I obviously chose a different one for those that didn't look at the poll question. I'll get to that in a second. But I wanted to ask the question, is Ryan Coulter your ride-or-die goalkeeper for the rest of the season? And I think he is. I think he has to be because Brian Silvestri, he's a wonderful goalie, but you have to ride the fact that Ryan Coulter is playing at such a high level. Why take him out at this point? Yes, I understand he's a goalkeeper coach first and a player second, but when he is the arguably one of the best goalies in the league right now, and that's not to say Brian Silvestri maybe couldn't be if he's in, it would be so foolish at this point to take him out. And that's why I feel like this is why it's Ryan Coulter or it would make no sense in my opinion at this point to bring in Brian Silvestri. So if Silvestri is the starting goalie against Chattanooga, that worries me and that concerns me because you're essentially pulling somebody that has already been nominated and already been playing at such a high level within the league and getting a lot of recognition. It wouldn't make sense to make that change at this point. Ryan Coulter needs to have a slew of bad games before you all of a sudden talk about having Brian step in. Obviously, Brian will find starting time at some point this season, but for right now, we all need to jump on the Ryan Coulter train and say, look, then this is where we're going and this is how we're going to get there. And this is how we're going to compete at a high level. And I feel like that, among many other things, is going to be a big difference moving forward. Well, fall or winter, however you want to call it, returned to the great state of Wisconsin on Tuesday night in Milwaukee when Forward Madison went down to Eline Soccer Park and got a 2-0 victory over the Milwaukee Bavarians in the first round of the Lamar Hunt U.S. Open Cup. Goals from Brandon Eaton and Hiro Toyama were the difference, even though the Bavarians did their very best to spoil and play Cinderella. And there was even a great write-up about them on the cup.us as well, but that ended up not being the case. Cinderella is going to have to come from somewhere else in the country this year. Maybe it'll be Forward Madison. You never know. You never know once you start getting into those next round matches who those teams are going to be. But of course, everyone's always looking at the semi-pro teams. Takeaways from this game, Brian Silvestri didn't have much to do in goal. I know I just talked about it a little bit ago, but he was challenged maybe a couple of times, maybe, and he made a couple of good saves. But Eric Leonard, he's a workhorse. Hiro Toyama, he's a workhorse. Brian Bemmett, he's good at hold-up play. He's not good at doing anything else as far as he gets the great, he did his great job of receiving the ball and distributing it. But as a forward, you also need to be able to then, you know, be the one creating offensive chances, in my opinion. Maybe I'm old school that way where I think you should be able to pass and distribute, but you should also be able to then turn and face and shoot. And I don't think we're seeing a lot of that from Bemmett right now. I'm still really torn about Zaire Bartley. I really am not impressed at all with anything he's done this season. I feel like he just never looks like he knows where he is on the field, and I feel like he never really gets a strong gauge of, no matter how much time he gets on the field, I've never been impressed with him this season yet, unfortunately. So I'm hopeful that he will continue to keep growing and keep developing, but every time he's been on the field, he looks like he doesn't know where he's supposed to go, and he looks like he is, unfortunately, in a very lost sheep sort of position, and he's just wandering around. I also will need to say this because the defense was sound. Connor Tobin did a great job. Obviously, you had Carl in there, Christian Diaz. The team looks like it's really coming together, and it looks like we are seeing what Forward Madison is capable of doing on a quick turnaround by not having to play all of their starting 11 players. And the announcers said it a couple of times. You're obviously trying to play some of your second team guys who are trying to earn first team minutes. And I think you definitely saw a couple of guys out there tonight that certainly are continuing to make a case. Brandon Eaton was one of them. It was great to see Brandon Eaton out running around. Nearly had two goals. He had a second one just ricochet off of the crossbar. And it was a good sight to see that he looked like he was feeling it, and that he was in the man in form. So I'm really grateful that we were able to see Brandon Eaton get out there after kind of just some quiet from him the first couple of weeks, and obviously Don Smart and the rest of the squad taking care of business. 2-0 the score when it came to that one. We asked the question on Twitter this week. We said, and some of you were very vocal, so I appreciate that, but here's the question we asked on Twitter this week. We said, who has proven to be the most valuable to Forward Madison so far this season? And we said, comment if it should be someone else should be considered. And we had Ryan Coulter, Don Smart, Connor Tobin, and Josiel Nunez. 77% of you said Ryan Coulter has been the most valuable to Forward Madison. Now, I agree. I 100% agree with you, but I also have to challenge you because Don Smart is who got my vote. And my thought about this is because, yes, this was not even having anything to do with his performances last week. I have been very vocal with many folks about Don Smart because his presence on the field, take the red card aside in Orlando, it was a mental mistake, shouldn't have happened. But I look at Don Smart and I look at the commitment, I look at the touches, I look at the distribution, I look at the confidence on the ball. You don't see anybody else playing with that same high level. But of course, the best clear-cut option is Ryan Coulter. And that's why he won the poll question this week. It makes total sense. I can't argue with it. He's come up massive. He's made incredible saves. He's kept us in games. He continues to play at a high level. Hence why, as we mentioned, he has the starting job. I will say that it was an interesting thing to see here. A couple people commented. So we had Forward Madison France. Their account on Twitter said, while I appreciate Smart's efforts, most notably in Saturday's game, absolutely no one comes close to Coulter, in my opinion. And many folks agreed with that. We also had Tim, one of our good friends. He said, as I write this in, Don is in second place, higher than in voting than Connor. Hopefully this doesn't end up reflecting the final poll results. I feel Connor should be number two on the list. Don was great Saturday. However, the red card against OCB2 could have been devastating for this team had we tied, lost the match, and or lost to Greenville. We were in desperate need for positive momentum, and that could have hurt the team. And then you also saw Flamingos. He said, I literally had a hand in his red card, and I think he made up for it with Saturday's showing. Though the correct answer is Ryan Coulter, I hope that three goals is a new trend, but the back has been the foundation. I can't argue. I can't. I mean, it's great to see. And if you can have a quality product coming out of the back end like we are from Ryan Coulter in the back four, more power to you as far as I care, honestly. Listen, folks, this has been fun. This has been a good show because we had a lot of fun, as we always do. And I want, of course, have to say a big thank you to everyone that continues to make what I do and Maddie's job just so much fun. And we get an opportunity to have some more fun again this coming weekend, as I've mentioned, May 11th. If you're looking for something to do, come on down. Come hang out with us at The Hive in Milwaukee, Wisconsin from 2 to 4 p.m. There'll be free food, free drinks. We're going to be interviewing a couple of members from the flock. Omar, April, and Andrew are all going to be there, and it is going to be a lot of fun. For all of us here at Forward Madison and Let Me Be Forward, I'm Baxter Colburn, saying a big thank you for tuning in, a big thank you on behalf of Maddie Cum, and it is going to be something special this coming weekend, not only for us, but of course, as we cheer on the Mingos as they take on Chattanooga as well. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you guys next time. Have a good one.